Amen, sister. Amen. Brothers and sisters, Pastor Getteh is ready. And I know that we are very much blessed with the messages that pertain to the grace of God. Pastor Getteh, it's your time. I leave it in your hands. May God bless you.
Thank you. Praise the Lord. It is a great blessing to join you once more to worship our Creator. As you know, this week's theme is grace galore, grace in profusion, grace in abundance. And our theme text is Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 to 10. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 to 10. And from this profound passage of scripture, we see six amazing things about the grace of God. First, we learn that we are saved by grace. We also learn that we are saved through faith. We are saved as a gift. We are saved not of works. We are saved for God. We are saved unto good works. These are amazing truths about our salvation. Today, we are continuing our study of this profound passage of scripture, and we are officially leaving, of course, the 8th and the 9th verses of the passage. Today, our focus will be on the 10th verse, Ephesians chapter 2, verse number 10. And as you flip the pages of your Bibles to this profound passage of scripture, I wish to remind you that I believe in the supremacy of the scripture. I believe in the sufficiency of the scripture. And I believe in the summation or the totality of the scripture. So let us read Ephesians chapter 2, verse number 10. Notice what the Bible says here. It says, "For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them." Inspired by this passage, our message this morning is titled, "The Portrait of the Savior." The Portrait of the Savior. Remember, we informed you that Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 to 9, are concerned with theology. Theological, you know, deliberations. Chapter 2, verse 10 is particularly concerned with the practical aspects or the ethical aspects or the application of the wonderful theological concepts. So as we go into God's word today, let us pray that the Holy Spirit, who inspired the word of God in its entirety, will illuminate this passage. Father, we ask that the Holy Spirit will teach us to understand fully and apply Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. And as it has pleased you to use a frail, filthy, and feeble vessel as myself, I do not ask for mighty words of human wisdom to move the audience. All I ask now, O Lord, is that humanity will diminish and that divinity will dominate as you speak to us pointedly, powerfully, and personally, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. So our study is titled The Portrait of the Savior. And as I've pointed out, our focus will be Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. And there are three important things we will discover as we walk through the passage. We will learn the master's masterpiece, the making of the masterpiece, and the manner or the practice or conduct of the masterpiece. Let's go into this text together. First, we will look at the master's masterpiece. Look at chapter 2, verse number 10. The Bible says here, "For we are his workmanship." We have once more encountered that word "for." For we are his workmanship. You see, the conjunction for, which is ga in, you know, the Greek, is a term of explanation, as we learned on the first day of our, you know, series. It always calls, you know, for us to pause for a moment and reflect on what is about to be said, to ponder what is presented before us. So particularly, my dear brothers and sisters, this pronoun is used in a conjunction, rather, is used in chapter 2, verse 8, to talk about the purpose of salvation. For by grace you have been saved. In chapter 2, verse 10, the particular focus is the purpose of the saved. The purpose of the saved. It says, for we are his workmanship. For we are his workmanship. So as I mentioned in chapter 2, verse number 8, the purpose is actually, the purpose for saving us is to display us as trophies of God's grace. But then in chapter 2, verse 10, you see another purpose, and that is the purpose of the saved. And the purpose of the saved is to demonstrate the triumph of God's grace, to demonstrate the triumph of God's grace in designing a cherished work of art, that is relationship and workers of good actions, that is work or right living. I like to quote from Ellen White, you know, relative to this concept of the saved, the purpose of the saved. She says in heaven, page 81, you know, paragraph 1, she says, in that day, the redeemed will shine forth in the glory of the Father and the Son. The angels, touching their golden harps, will welcome the King and his trophies of victory. Those who have been washed and made white in the blood of the Lamb, a song of triumph will peal forth, filling all heaven. Christ has conquered. He enters the heavenly courts, accompanied by his redeemed ones, the witnesses that his mission of suffering and sacrifice has not been in vain. Trophies of victory. Friends, we are his workmanship. So the first thing here, we see the master's masterpiece. But look at the text again with me, please. You see the products of this project. This master has made a masterpiece through a project. Now, what is the product, or who are the products of this project? Look at verse number 10 again. It says, for we are. Who are his workmanship? We. Now, please take note of the previous text. If you study chapter 2, verse 1, you learned that we are his workmanship. Those who now are referred to as we, okay, are those who were dead in trespasses, according to chapter 2, verse 1. Are those who walked according to the course of this world, okay, according to chapter 2, verse 2, were those who walked according to the will of Satan, according to chapter 2, verse 2, those who lived in the lust of the flesh and mind, according to chapter 2, verse number 3, are those who by nature were children of wrath, according to chapter 2, verse number 3. Now we are his workmanship. We who were once dead in sin, destined for destruction because the wages of sin is death, are now saved, as Paul says in chapter 2, verse number 8. For by grace we have been saved. For by grace you have been saved. Okay? And then here he says, for we are his workmanship. This inclusive we covers Gentiles and Greeks who were once lost but are now redeemed, and now they are the products. Oh yes, the products of the project of salvation. They were once the objects of God's grace, and now they are the products of God's salvation. Amazing, isn't it? So amazing. Brothers and sisters, those who were dead are now alive. Those who walked according to the course of this world now walk in love. Those who walk according to the will of Satan now walk according to the will of God. Those who walk in the lust of the flesh now are led by the Holy Spirit. Those who by nature were the children of wrath are now the children of God. Amazing, isn't it? But let us see something else in the text. The proprietor of the product. Who is the owner of the product? The text says, for we are his workmanship. We are his workmanship. In other words, friends, we are owned by God. It will amaze you to note that the pronoun his that is used in that text is placed in the first place, if you look at the Greek sentence, and it is placed there for emphasis. So here's how you would translate that literally from the Greek. His. For we are workmanship. His, for we are workmanship. You see, the position of the pronoun at the beginning of the sentence renders it emphatic. The possessive pronoun his, therefore, indicates ownership or sole proprietorship. God owns the product. God owns us. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 19 to 20, or do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit? He goes on to say, who is in you, whom you have from God, and you are not your own, for you were bought at a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. You were bought at a price. You are God's cherished possession. We are the product of God. But there's something else you must note from the text, and that is the priority of the product. He says, for we are his workmanship. Workmanship, that word is poema in, you know, the Greek, and it's from poi, and which means to make, and for ma, the result of. And in English, this is translated as poem, or workmanship, or it is the source of the English word poem. Thus, the word means something that is composed or that is constructed, something that is made, that which is manufactured, that which is produced, something that is designed, something that is amazing. For instance, that word poema actually could mean a statue or perhaps a song, an architecture or a poem or a painting. The text says we are his workmanship. We are his carefully crafted poem. We are his masterpiece. We are his wonderful product. In other words, friends, we are the master's masterpiece. We are the cherished possession of God. We are the product of his wonderful work of art. That same word is used in the New Testament, okay, in Romans chapter 1, verse 20, where the Bible talks about things that are made. This is used for creative acts of God. The same term is used in the LXS or the, you know, Septuagint, okay, the Greek translation of the Old Testament, in Psalm 143, verse number 5. I remember the days of old, I meditate on all your works, and muse on the works of your hand. Poema is again here used to refer to God's work in creation. Brothers and sisters, in our text, it is about God's work in redemption, how that he has redeemed us, how that he has made us his cherished possession, how that he has made us. No wonder the Bible says in Psalm 139, verse 14, that we are fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are his works. Friends, we were made in creation. We are made in redemption. Glory be to the name of God. It is Michelangelo, this wonderful, you know, artist who once asked what he was doing as he was chipping away, you know, a very shapeless, you know, rock. When he was asked what he was doing with that rock, he said, I am liberating an angel from this stone. I am liberating an angel from this stone. You see, that's what God is doing with us. We are in the hands of the great maker, the ultimate sculptor who created the universe out of nothing. His tools are Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit, his word and the preaching of the word of God. Brothers and sisters, yes, indeed, God made us in creation. God remade us in redemption, and he is constantly conforming our hearts and our lives to that of the Lord Jesus Christ. Brothers and sisters, let's consider the second part of our study. The second part of our study today is mainly concerned with the making of the masterpiece. The making of the masterpiece. Chapter 2, verse number 10. Notice what the Bible says here. Chapter 2, verse number 10. It says, for we are his workmanship, created. Created. Interesting, isn't it? That word created is a very powerful word. It simply means to bring something into existence or to call into being. Created. The Greek word used there is to describe the founding of a place or of a city or of a colony. It actually points to saved sinners as new creation in Christ. In fact, the word is used in the aorist, okay, tense. And what that means is that it points to the time in past when the incidents happened. But the result is continuing, okay? The specific creator act, you know, has happened or it has taken place at a point in time in the past, but the result is today in the believer's life. We were created in Christ Jesus. The Bible says in the book of Ezekiel chapter 36, 26 to 27, I will give you a new heart, a new spirit. I will put within you, and I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh, and I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes. God is saying, hey, this is how I will remake you. I will put my spirit in you. But look at the makeup. We are created, recreated, but we are created in Christ Jesus. Now, that is a powerful statement. In Christ Jesus. In Christ there does not mean inside Christ. No, it's not inside Christ as a tool is in a bus. No, it does not mean inside Christ as a water is in the bucket. No, it actually means to be organically united to Christ. Just like a limb is to the body or a branch is to the tree. So we are linked organically to the Lord Jesus Christ. No wonder Paul tells us in 2 Corinthians 5:17, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. If anyone is organically connected to Christ, he is a new creation. All things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Friends, the Bible says in the book of Ephesians 4:20 to 24, but you have not so learned Christ, if indeed you have heard him and have been taught by him as the truth is in, you know, Jesus. He continues, then put off concerning your former conduct the old man, which grows corrupt according to the deceitful lust, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind. It continues in, you know, the next verse, and that you put on the new man, which was created according to God in true righteousness and holiness. Colossians chapter 3, verse 10, the Bible says, and have put on the new man, who is being renewed in knowledge according to the image of him who created him. Brothers and sisters, we are created in Christ Jesus for good works. We are organically connected to Jesus, just like the branch is connected to the vine, just like the branch is connected to the tree, just like the limb is connected to the body. We are connected to Christ Jesus. And this is what the recreation has actually resulted in. Listen, my friend, we are abiding in Christ Jesus. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 1:30, but of him you are in Christ Jesus, who became for us wisdom from God and righteousness. Okay, wisdom from God and righteousness and sanctification and redemption. I like what John Calvin says, Christ cannot be divided into parts. So the two things, justification and sanctification, which are perceived to be united together in him, are inseparable. In Christ. What an amazing truth today. We are a new creation. We are brand new beings. And if any man be in Christ, he's a new creation. The blessing of the master's masterpiece. Let us pray. Father, thank you for this blessed opportunity. Thank you for your word. Honor your word now by transforming every heart that reaches out to you for renewal and for transformation. We give you all the glory for answered prayer in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Amen, Pastor. May God bless you.